day for our church. Today is a special day because today is Vision Sunday 2023. What in the world does that mean? Well, you're going to find out here in a little bit. This entire month, the entire month of January, we've been talking about the importance of having either a healthy, actually we should have a healthy and not an unhealthy cadence or rhythm of our lives personally. And just like that fact, that we as human beings, we as people have a personal cadence. Churches have a rhythm, have a cadence to the way they do things just as well. Whether churches want to admit it or not, all churches have a cadence. They all have rhythms. And it's usually first and foremost seen in how they conduct a weekend service. There is a certain order of things that have to be done a certain way, or some people get really nervous. You can't have the offering before the song. You can't have the sermon before the offering. At least that's what I've heard in some churches. We try to stay with a certain cadence here in our weekend service, and every now and then we mix up that rhythm. And for some of you, you get real nervous, just like I was describing. For others of you, it's like, finally, something new. We're doing something different, and it's okay to do things different. Just like it's important to have that internal, that personal, spiritual rhythm of our life, churches need an internal, they need some kind of cadence in their life. And not only does it flesh itself out in how we do church in a worship service, but it also is seen in what churches schedule in their annual calendar. Some churches do certain things a certain time of year, and you can tell what kind of church it is by what kind of events, what kind of activities they schedule on their annual calendar. That cadence of a church not only determines where they're at spiritually, where they're at in the ministry, but it also determines where they're going to go in the future. That's why we do certain things a certain time of year. That's why we have certain activities, certain events on our calendar. And that's also why we don't have certain events on our calendar. Because if we were to do everything that's possible, not only is it not healthy to do everything possible, you guys know that as well. If you pack too many things in your personal cadence, you get exhausted. You have to have a certain pace, a healthy pace. Churches need to have that healthy pace as well. But there are certain things churches and we will choose not to do, as well as there are certain things in our calendar that we will choose to do on a regular basis. Because those events, that cadence, it helps determine where we're going in the future. I don't know about you, but I want to ask you a question. How many of you have ever been lost, and I mean really lost in the woods? Really lost. A few years ago, we were elk hunting out in Montana in the Rocky Mountains. As we were climbing the mountain, the winter storm came in on us. So we're headed up the mountain. And as we're going up there, the snow started falling. By the time we got to the top of the mountain where we thought the elk were at, snow was really coming down. A fog had come in, and it was very quick to realize we're in the middle of the Rocky Mountains, and I don't know where we came from. I don't know how to get out of here. There was no opportunity. You know, it's always find the sun, and that'll determine what direction you're at. You couldn't see the sun. You couldn't see the moon. I mean, you were lucky to see 50 feet in front of you because of the fog. When I was a Boy Scout, we were taught that anytime you get lost, the very first thing is build a fire. Don't scream for help. No, don't scream for help. The very first thing you do is don't panic. Don't panic. Stay where you're at. Stop and figure out where you're at. That's the very first thing they tell you in Boy Scouts. If you ever get lost, don't panic and figure out how did you get to where you're at? What direction did you come from? Well, that was a little nerve-wracking because as I was sharing with you about that elk trip, We couldn't figure out where we came from. Our trail that we were on was completely snowed over. Now we couldn't, there was no footprints to follow back. So we couldn't figure out where we were coming from or where we had come from. The second thing that usually helps us, figure out where you came from, but then figure out, okay, where are we currently at? Maps are really good for that. Especially if you can read maps, right, honey? Yeah. Figure out, pull a map out, where am I at? Before I have to find out where I'm at before I can figure out where I go, where I want to go. And then, once you figure out where you're at, then you can determine, okay, where do I need to go, either back to the car or the truck or the house or wherever you're going. Then you can figure out where you need, what direction you need to go. Last fall, our church did a kind of a fun event. We went to a corn maze out in DeKalb. And the Boyers and my family, Renee and I and Jen, we went out and we thought it'd be great to do a corn maze. And so we get out in this corn maze and we had some navigators that kind of got lost and couldn't figure out. Not only did they get lost, the adults got lost. We didn't know where we were at. And the first rule is don't panic. Some people were panicking. I won't name who was panicking or not, but some people were panicking. We're lost. We'll never get out of here. It's a corn maze. We can always walk through the corn. All right, but some people were panicking. Let's determine how did we get to where we were at. Let's look at the map. Let's figure out where did we come from. Oh, we came from that direction. All right, let's pull the map out. Here's where we're at. Listen to the music that's playing, and that'll give us a direction. And it was once we did those things that our navigator said, oh, here's where we're at. Here's where we need to go. Let's go this direction. And they did a fantastic job of walking us right out of that corn maze. Good job, Jada. That's what happens in so many of our lives. We get lost in the shuffle, and churches get lost in the shuffle and the activity of just doing church and doing things that churches do. And pretty soon they realize we're lost. We have no idea what we're doing and why we're doing what we're doing. Today I want to talk about why are we doing what we're doing and where is that going to take us if we continue. Today I want us to look at some passages from the Old Testament book of Joshua. So if you would, open your Bibles to Joshua chapter 4. And we're going to look at Joshua chapter 4 to begin with. And we're going to see that in the Old Testament, especially in the Old Testament book of Joshua, stones meant something. Stones represented something. Stones were almost symbols of God doing something and for the people to realize that God had done something to make acknowledgement of what he had done. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that you love us. I thank you that you love Grace Evangelical Church and that you have brought some incredibly good leaders, good pastors to this church in the past. And yet through all that leadership in the past, you have been the over-shepherd through our 60-plus years of ministry, of serving in this community. And today I believe without any doubt that you are the head of this church. We want to continue in that posture, that you are the leader of this church. That it's not me, it's not the elders, it's not the deacons, it's not any individual. You are the leader of this church. Today, as we consider the future that you have for us, I ask that you would give us your wisdom, not our wisdom, your wisdom. And I ask that you let us humbly submit ourselves to your leadership, not only today, but also in our future, to help determine the direction and the future of this congregation. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, just like I said, you know, when you get lost, you need to do a few things. What I want us to do is I want us to first look at where we've been. The children of Israel had to give, they had to get their grip on where have they been. And if you know anything about Joshua, you know that the children of Israel have been in Egypt in bondage for over 400 years. That's where they had been. They had been in bondage for 400 years. God raises up the leader Moses. Moses not only had been trained by the Egyptians, but he had given, God had given him the School of Hard Knocks and Burning Bush seminary experience. And so through Moses, they are delivered from their bondage of Egypt. They march over into the promised land. They send in 12 spies. 10 of those spies come back and say, man, we are grasshoppers in their eyes. Those guys are giants. They have walled and fortified cities. We can't do it. Two guys of those 12 say, God's in this. We're on God's team. He can win the victory. Let's go for it. Majority rules. Just like in most churches, majority rules. And in that group of people, the Israelites, the Hebrews, the majority ruled. And for the next 40 years, they wandered around in the desert because of unbelief. By the time we get to Joshua chapter 4, Moses, their great leader, is dead. And they have a new leader. That new leader has not been trained. He's not been gifted as well as Moses. But Joshua is the one that God chose to bring them into the promised land. He is their leader. So they finally cross the Jordan River. And they cross the Jordan River. This whole new generation crosses the Jordan River just like their ancestors had done. The previous generation had crossed the Red Sea. They had crossed on dry land. And as they crossed on their dry land, God was in essence saying to them, this is a new generation, and I am going to do a new work with these people, with you as my people. As they crossed the Jordan River in Joshua chapter 4, Joshua gives some pretty strange instructions to the leaders. And it has to do with 12 stones. Look at Joshua chapter 4. When all the nation had finished passing over the Jordan, the Lord said to Joshua, take 12 men from the people, from each tribe a man, and command them, saying, take 12 stones from here out of the midst of the Jordan, from the very place where the priest's feet stood firmly, and bring them over with you and lay them down in the place where you lodge tonight. Then Joshua called the 12 men from the people of Israel, whom he had appointed, a man from each tribe. And Joshua said to them, pass on before the ark of the Lord, your God, in the midst of the Jordan, and take up each one of you a stone upon his shoulder, according to the number of the tribes of the people of Israel, that this may be a sign among you. When your children ask in time to come, what do these stones mean to you? Then you shall tell them that the waters of the Jordan was cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, when it passed over the Jordan, and the waters of the Jordan were cut off. So these stones shall be to the people of Israel a memorial forever. If you know the story, you know what happens. They get to the Jordan River. The priest holding the ark or carrying the ark step foot in the water and it parts. It divides just like the Red Sea. The ground turns dry and they begin marching across from Moab over into the Promised Land. As they get in the middle of the Jordan River, Joshua instructs them, take a stone. Have each man take a stone and put it on their shoulder. Now, as you can see, this is not a small stone. Now, I don't know how big those stones are. None of us know how big those stones are. But they take them out of the midst of the Jordan, where the water once was. And they put it on their shoulder. They carry it to the place where they're going to camp the night that night. And that those stones are to be a memorial. They are to speak to the people. That is clearly what Joshua has been told by the Lord. This was their first victory. This was their first special event. They finally, after leaving Egypt, enter into the promised land. And God is speaking to them saying, every time you see those stones, you remember I'm at work among you. I am doing a new work in you. Well, if we jump ahead to two chapters, to Joshua chapter 6, we read about Israelites conquering the first mighty city, Jericho. And we know that if you know the story, there is a unique battle plan that God has them, you know, do. And they follow the plan to a T, and everything works out just as God had promised. Things couldn't be going better for the Hebrews at this point. They're in the promised land, the first mighty city, the city that those 10 faithless spies said, we can't do it. The first city falls without them raising a sword. God was at work, and they were on the high of the highest of possible spiritual events. Looking back in our past is a good thing. I don't know how often you do that. You take inventory of your past. But it's a good thing to look back on your past. You may have a lot of high moments, just like the Hebrews had at this point. You may have had a few low moments. We're going to get to those in just a minute. But in each time we look to our past, we're reminded God is at work and was at work in my past. God had been doing something in my past. That's why it's good to look back on our past. What about the past? What about the history of Grace Evangelical Church? Some of you know the history. Some of you may not. If you know it, please make sure that I think I got all my facts right. All right? In December of 1959, the Lord led a group of 150-ish people to start a new church here in the Elgin area. They named the church Grace Evangelical Church. They began meeting in a school. 1 year later, 1 year after they began meeting, the same group of people purchased 2 acres right here on Bowes Road. 2 acres of the now 8 acres that the church sits on. In November, 2 years later, this worship building, this building was dedicated. Do the math. 1 year, 1959, they meet together as a new church. 3 years later, they're in the building. 3 years, they're in the building. That's incredible. 10 years after that, the additional building, the gym and the downstairs classrooms was built in the early 1970s. We today are reaping the benefits. We are reaping and enjoying the blessing that those Grace Evangelical Church people have given to us, that sacrificed and worked hard for. We are enjoying the fruit of their labor, the sacrifices that they made, the faithfulness that they had continued to serve the Lord, and we are enjoying what they have done. The next 25 years, the Lord multiplied this church both numerically and financially in incredible ways. Grace reached its highest average attendance in 1997, averaging 377 people. Averaging 377. So that means that there were multiple services that were over 400. 2 services. The people of Grace must have been feeling just like those Hebrews after their victory over Jericho. God was incredibly blessing them. They were at the highest of the high. For a multitude of reasons, though, 10 years later, in 2007, the average attendance had dropped by 100 people. The church was still averaging 272 people in 2007. The church saw even greater challenges the next 10 years. And by 2017, the average attendance of this church was in the 170s. And for the most part, people would look at 170 in attendance and say, well, that's still a really big church. But in 20 years, they had lost 200 people. 2018 and 2019 were extremely difficult years. If you were around in those years here in this building, you know just how hard those were. Renee and I attended for the first time in the fall of 2019. And we could tell you guys had been through a lot. In March, on March 14, 2020, 66 people voted me in as your seventh pastor. I think I've got the numbers right. I think it was 66, and I do believe I'm the seventh pastor of this church. If you know anything about 2020, you know that Illinois had its state lockdown due to COVID the very next day, March 15th, 2020. And so for 3 months, we as a congregation could not assemble. We could not gather together to worship the Lord. We did a lot of things online. There was some, you know, the best we could. But we gathered back for the first time on Father's Day of 2020. Like I said, it's a good thing to get an understanding of where we've been as a church. But it's also good to look at those stones and to see they are markers that God was at work. Even in the rough times, God was at work. I don't believe for any stretch of the imagination that God is done with the congregation at Grace Evangelical Church. Do you? Apparently you don't, because you're here. You still have the confidence, you still hope that God is at work here, even though the last 5 years have been incredibly difficult. All right, so that's where we've been. Let's look at where we're at. The children of Israel had just had their mighty victory at Jericho. In Joshua chapter 7, we read about how the Israelites get their first major defeat as they enter into the promised land. God had been very, very clear. After the battle of Jericho, none of the good things, none of the spoils of war, the good things that the people of Jericho had were to be taken by individuals. Everything was to belong to the Lord. God was also very clear about battle instructions. And his battle instructions were, every time you go into battle, all the fighting men go. All of them. You take them all. But they come to this little city called Ai, or many of you know it as Ai, Ai. They come to Ai, and they spy it out, and they say, it's a small town. We don't need to take all the mighty men, all the fighting men. Let's just take 3,000. Yeah, that'll be enough. And then there was this other guy, this guy named Achan. Achan thought God's instructions were suggestions. You know, you can kind of take them or leave them. By the way, just for, you know, humor me here. You're in the wilderness. There is no Macy's. There's no Target. There's no Walmart. And you show up and you've got a brand new coat on. And it's not just a brand new coat. It's a brand new Babylonian coat. You think somebody's going to notice? And then you've got this wedge of gold and this wedge of silver. Where are you going to spend it? Achan, by the way, you're going to find out, was already a rich guy. What was he thinking? He took a Babylonian garment, a wedge of gold and a wedge of silver, and he buried it in his tent, and he thought no one would find out. One of those, duh. You're going to bury it forever? Eventually, you want to wear that thing, right? And then somebody's going to notice, hey, you didn't go to Walmart yesterday, did you? Where'd that come from? He would have some explaining to do, wouldn't he? Anyway, they go to this little town called Ai with 3,000 men. And when they get there, they are incredibly defeated. The Bible says it this way. In Joshua 7, verse 5, it says that they were demoralized. And the hearts of the people, the hearts of the people of Israel, they melted and became as water. I am sure Joshua and the people of Israel felt, God, what is going on? You've abandoned us. This would have been an easy city. It was nothing like Jericho. God hadn't abandoned them, did he? They had abandoned God. They had taken matters in their own hands, both as a group by taking only 3,000 men and by Achan thinking, oh, God's rules are only suggestions, and they suffered the consequences. God can never bless sin. God can never bless disobedience. And we're going to see that he is going to use stones once again to remind them God will not bless disobedience. And through a miraculous series of events, the Lord showed Joshua and the people exactly who had sinned by taking the garment and the gold. Joshua chapter 7, verse 24. And Joshua and all of Israel took him, that's Achan, took Achan, the son of Zerah, and the silver and the cloak and the bar of gold and his sons and his daughters and his oxen and donkey and sheep and his tent and all that he had. You see, he was a rich person. Why he thought he needed this makes no sense. And they brought them up to the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, why did you bring trouble on us? The Lord brings trouble on you today. And all of Israel stoned him with stones. They burned them with fire and stoned them with stones, and they raised over him a great heap of stones that remain to this day. Then the Lord turned from his burning anger. Therefore, to this day, the name of the place is called the Valley of Achor. Can you imagine a pile of stones over a group of people? And I'm sure, I am confident, that pile of stones over Achan and his family and all his stuff was much bigger than that pile of stones. Every time they saw those stones, they knew those stones spoke of three things. They spoke of God is not going to bless sin. God was righteous, and God will continue to be righteous. We need to honor and obey his instruction. We need to honor and obey his word. And this represents the consequences of not obeying. Every time they saw that mound of stone, they knew God was righteous, and they had to obey him. Those stones from that day forward reminded the people that God was at work, but they reminded them of another thing, God's grace and his mercy. God didn't kill all the Hebrews. There was only 30-some people that had died at the Battle of Achor. It was only Achan and his family who, by the way, if you're wondering why were they also punished, how do you hide it? They were living together. In that day and time, families lived in the same tent together. They had to know what Achan had done. And they had hid it. And they had gone along with Achan's deception. But those stones represented God's grace, his mercy. That while they were yet defeated, God remained faithful. God remained caring and involved in their lives. And not all the people were punished. So what does that mean about the present for Grace Evangelical Church? What does the present day look like for Grace Evangelical Church? Well, I believe we've had our defeat at AI. I believe that's in our past. I believe we've had our Valley of Achor. It is a sobering place, isn't it? We're not as mighty as we once were. There's not 400 people in this building anymore. But God is still at work. We also realize this. Not only are we not as mighty as we once were, we realize that we have a real enemy. A real enemy. And sometimes we are our own worst enemy. Sometimes things that happen to us are our own fault. Just like in the day of Achan. He had created. It was one of the very own Hebrews. Our enemy is real, but sometimes we're our own worst enemy. But we are also in an incredible place that we should feel a relief, a reassurance that God is still for us. That he has not abandoned this church. He's still at work in people's lives. He's still wanting to bless this congregation. We're in a good place. Just like the Hebrews were in a good place after the defeat of Ai. They were in a good place because now they had reached the point where they weren't cocky and confident in themselves anymore. They were now much more dependent on the Lord. Each and every day, they were more dependent on him. At the end of 2019, if you were here in this church in the year of 2019, most of the leaders that I spoke with, and maybe some of you, you weren't quite sure if this church would be open much longer. Amen? You can agree if you agree. When I talked with people in the fall of 2019, talked with several people, the word that I heard more often or not, we're not sure how much longer we're going to be open. Last year, we averaged almost 90 people in our Sunday services. Now, that's not 377. But did you know, put this statistic up there, Jen, one half of all North American churches have an average worship attendance below 65. Do you know that? We are in the upper 50%. That should make you feel good. The average church in North America runs less than 100. More than, it's in the upper 60% of churches in North America run 100 or less. I want to encourage you to read the reports in the that have been printed. I want you to read, you know, what our ministry leaders and what our staff and what I've said in those annual reports of what God has done last year. To me, it's exciting. God is at work here at Grace. Not just in the financial, and you're going to hear about that in our annual meeting, but in the lives of people. People's lives are being changed. God is doing a work here at this church. I want you to be encouraged by that. Each week, God's word has been faithfully proclaimed. We have sang out praises to the Lord. Our church has had incredible love for one another. Our staff and our leaders have an amazing unity. Lives in this church have been changed by the power of the gospel, and they have been transformed in a whole new direction. And through all of this, I hope you have seen God pour out his blessing on us. God has proved that he is faithful if we will be faithful to him. He is faithful if we honor him. But where we're at doesn't have anything really to do with where we're going in the future. I've already shared that with you in the history of this church. Where are we going? Where are we going in this year, in the years ahead? I am sure the people of Israel thought the same thing. They had their defeat at Ai. Okay, where are we going next? We're going to give up? We're going to camp right here? What are we going to do? God had proven that he had given them, sorry, He had proven that he had given them that land. He had proven that he had, he had given them a battle plan to go back to Ai, follow my instructions, and see what God is going to do, what he is going to do for them. He had given them, an incredible battle plan. They follow it to the T, and they win the victory at Ai. Excuse me, Ai, the second time. Joshua and the people then said, you know what? We have learned a lesson. Follow the Lord. Follow his instructions. Let him be the leader, and everything will work out. And in Joshua chapter 8, we read that they renewed a covenant, their commitment to the Lord. Look at Joshua chapter 8, verse 30. At that time, Joshua built an altar to the Lord and the people of Israel on Mount Ebal, just as Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded the people of Israel, as it is written in the book of the law of Moses, an altar of uncut stones upon which no man had wielded an iron tool. And they offered on it burnt offerings to the Lord and sacrificed peace offerings. And there, in the presence of the people of Israel, he wrote on the stones a copy of the law of Moses, which he had written. Can you imagine that? In that passage, there are two types of stone. There is a stone altar that they offer sacrifices to. But the other stones that Moses had written the law on were the tablets of stone. Do you remember when Moses went up on the mountain and he comes down with the tablets of stone? What did Moses do when he saw the people sinning? He smashed those stones. Joshua now rewrites those laws on new stone tablets for them. They had renewed their commitment. They renewed, made a new covenant with the Lord. We will remain faithful to your word, Lord. That altar of stones represented that the people, we have made a commitment. We have drawn a line. We have put it in stone. We will follow you from here on out. They had also had a renewed hope for what their future could hold and what it could be like. And now, they had a hope that was squarely placed on the Lord, not on themselves, not on how strong they were, but on the Lord and on him alone. I know many of you have seen the series, Hunger Games, right? Be honest, you've seen the Hunger Games, all right? Some of you have not seen the Hunger Games, okay. If you know anything about the Hunger Games, I won't give you the whole scoop, but there is a scene where President Snow, who is the evil leader of the capital city. Snow is no theologian, so I don't give him any credit for theology here, but he makes an incredible point about little hope is good and a lot of hope is dangerous. Question is, it's dangerous to who? Well, in the Hunger Games, it's dangerous to the capital, and it's dangerous to their control over the other 13 providences. And in the spiritual world, if Satan can't destroy all our hope, he'll say a little hope is okay. I'll just give you a little hope. Because with a little hope, there's a lot of doubt. There's a lot of wondering, was God really going to work? Because I'm only going to give you a little hope. Go ahead and show that scene.
Seneca, why do you think we have a winner?
What do you mean?
I mean, why do we have a winner? I mean, if we just wanted to intimidate the districts, why not round up 24 of them at random and execute them all at once? It'd be a lot faster. Hope.
Hope.
Hope. It is the only thing stronger than fear. A little hope is effective. A lot of hope is dangerous. A spark is fine, as long as it's contained.
So?
So contain it.
In God's economy, a little hope in the Lord is a good thing. And a lot of hope in the Lord is even better. Amen? We serve the God of hope. He is the God of all hope. And our hope here at this church is squarely placed on the Lord. It is not on ourselves. It is not on what we can do. It is not what we think we can do. Our hope is placed squarely on what the Lord can do. So what does the future of Grace Evangelical Church look like? Well, the focus of this year is going to be the same as it has for the last 3 years. For the last 3 years, there has been some things that we as a church have been moving towards and trying to instill, trying to put as a forefront. We're still going to proclaim God's word faithfully. We're still going to sing out praises to our Lord because he's worthy. We're going to continue to emphasize church love for one another. We're still going to have unity as the goal at every turn, every decision. We're striving for unity. We're going to strive to make life transformation the emphasis in everyone's life through the power of the gospel and through applying God's word to our lives personally. Those things aren't going to change this year or in our future. But where are we headed? Well, you heard me say earlier that we average just about the actual number. If you're wondering, Tim, how much are you rounding off? We average 89 people in 2020, so almost 90. And like I said, we're in the upper 50% of all the churches in North America. But I believe the Lord really wants to do a greater work here. We are blessed with a building that can hold more than 90 people. I think you and I know people. I think you and I have friends and acquaintances. I think we know people that would benefit from knowing the Lord, knowing about his great love for them, the salvation that comes through Jesus Christ and him alone. And the life transformation that can happen by plugging into a local church. The benefits that it can have for them. I believe you and I know people that need Jesus. Don't you? If you do, we need to reach those people. But how? How do we reach those people? And before I answer that question, let me give you another church statistic. Go ahead and put that statistic up, Jen. In a church, or in the average church in North America that runs 100 in their weekend attendance, the church will lose blank number each year. This is one of those statistics. This is one of these facts that when I heard this, it was like, wow, wow. The average church of 100 will lose one person to death this year. 9 people will move away. 7 people will transfer another church in the community. 15 people will stop coming or stopping attending the church because of declined attendance frequency. That equals 32 people will leave the church of 100 in the average churches in the United States. Let me explain what I'm saying here. If a church is running 100, the average church that runs 100 has to gain 32 people each year only to stay plateaued, only to stay the same as they did the year before. 32 new people have to start attending. In anything less than 32, the church is in decline. Is that eye-opening or what? When I read that statistic, when I saw that, at first I was in disbelief. Really? A church of 100 has to gain 32 new people every year just to maintain their same attendance number? What does that say to you and I? We're not quite 100, but that says, in essence, if we do the math, we have to gain about 28 people or 25 people new next year just to maintain what we have today. That's what it means. What it means to me is that all of us, not just the pastor and the staff and the elders and deacons, it is not just their responsibility. It is our responsibility. It is our privilege to begin inviting people to Jesus, inviting them to our church, not only to get the benefit of what a church means in their life, but what Jesus can do in their life both here and in eternity. It is our responsibility. It is our responsibility just to maintain our own attendance where we're at. So how are we going to do that this year? Well, I want to introduce you to two new tools. And elders, I am sorry, I talked about these in past elder meetings, but I didn't give you as much detail as I wish I did. Deacons, I know, deaconesses, you haven't heard this before. Two new tools. The first one we're going to start implementing in right away is called Invite Your One. Each and every one of us have one person in our life that is unsaved, that doesn't know Jesus as our Savior, or is unchurched. Begin inviting them. Begin praying for them. Begin having spiritual conversations with them. And the question that I'm going to have every week is, who's your one? You were somebody's one at one time. Somebody targeted you as their one. They invited you to Jesus. They invited you to church. At some point, you was somebody's one. Who are you going to target? Who are you going to go after? And I don't mean this in the wrong way. You know, it's not about numbers. It is not about notches on your belt. It is not about how many people you bring to Jesus. It's really, again, our hope is in the Lord alone. Our job is to invite. Our job is to introduce. We let God do what he's going to do. But we're going to start promoting and start offering tools for how do I invite my one. Do you know the statistic still is true? There was a large research done several years ago. 80% of the people that you invite to church will come if you just invite them. And we live in a culture, we live in a society to think, no, I've invited 100 people and no one came. Keep inviting, keep inviting. And if they won't come without you, then come, have them come with you. Offer to pick them up. Offer to meet them, you know, somewhere. Bring them with you. We can start doing that right away, inviting our ones. Second thing that we're going to do, as soon as the weather breaks, we're going to implement something called Pray and Go. I don't know how many of you have been around church long enough to know about community canvassing or door knocking. Sometimes it's called door knocking. This is not like that. It's not like that much. What it is you can do this in your neighborhood. We can do this in our church, and we're going to start doing this. We're going to get little flyers. We're going to make up flyers that basically said, we prayed for you, Grace Evangelical Church. If you ever have a need for a spiritual conversation, or if we could ever be of service to you, please contact us at, we'll have our information. We're going to hang that on their door. We're not going to knock on their door. We're not going to knock on their door. It's not going to be confrontational. It's going to be intentional, though, to let them know that we're a church in their community that care about them. And if they need something, we're available. And we're going to start doing that as soon as the weather breaks. You'd be surprised how many people in this community, they know this building, they see the building. I mean, it's kind of hard not to see the building. But they have no idea what we represent. They have no idea what we believe. They have no idea that we care about them. They have no idea that we have a Jesus that cares for them. And we have to show them, we have to demonstrate to them, we care for them. And we got to let the Holy Spirit, again, it's letting the Holy Spirit, letting God do his work that we can't do. All right. So let me wrap this message up, if I can. It's been my goal in this message to offer you a little more hope personally and a little more hope for our church collectively in this message. We serve a big God. I believe he wants to do some incredible things in this congregation. I don't believe he's finished with this church. I don't think that 90 is the plateau. I don't think, you know, what God does in the future is up to him. But I don't think 90 is his limit. But this can only happen if we obey him, if we love him, if we love one another, and if we faithfully serve him. It'll only happen as we work together. None of us can do this alone. It all has to be a corporate effort if we're going to make this accomplish. And it only happens as we invite our ones to Jesus and to this church. Years ago, the people at Grace Evangelical Church, they planted seeds. They sacrificed. They served faithfully. And you and I are reaping the benefits of what they did. I am sure they served for their own benefit, and I'm sure that they serve for their children and grandchildren. A lot of times we do work, especially if I'm looking at some of the older folks. I'm in that category now, all right? And I realize that at some point you're working hard for yourself. But you get to a certain age and you say, it's no longer about me. It's about my kids and my grandkids and those generations after me. What I am trying to instill in all of us today is let's serve the Lord for our kids, our grandkids, and those that will follow after us as we faithfully serve him today. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you that our future is in your hands. That all you call us to do is to be faithful to you. And as we are faithful to you, by the results. And just as these stones up here on the stage remind us of markers in our lives, it reminded the people of Israel of what you had done in their past. We have our own stones, not in this pile here, but in the walls and the halls of this building of those who had come before us. Allow us, Lord, to build and plant seeds for that next generation that follows after us. Allow us to remain faithful to you. Allow us to invite our ones and begin praying for one or two people that we know that have not yet made the decision to trust you as their Savior or grow in a local church. Our future is in your hands, Lord. It's not in ours. And our hope is in you because you are the God of all hope. Remind us of that each and every day. And we will trust you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen.